Final Fantasy. As a franchise that's seen over a dozen mainline RPGs, two MMOs, crossovers, side games, and God knows how much merchandise, there's no surprise that most people that have any experience with video games have usually played at least one of the series that it offers. But with all those different games comes a bunch of different levels of quality and opinions of said games. And if there's one thing that's widely agreed upon, even by yours truly, is that Final Fantasy VIII is among the weakest that the series has to offer. And yet I love it to death, and I want to share with you just why I like it so much. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, I am your ever-friendly PokerProf, and welcome back to Fascinating Fiction. So before we go any further into this particular subject, I'm wanting to give everyone a warning that I will be talking about major elements of the game and its story that people have issues with, and either my personal defense for them, or why I feel like people need to take another look. As such, there are going to be spoilers for Final Fantasy VIII here, so hopefully you're either okay with it, or you've played the game before and don't really need to worry. Just wanted to give you all a heads up. So, what's the immediate problem that people have with Final Fantasy VIII when you ask them about it? For those that I've actually talked to, they usually point to the major gameplay element of the game itself, the junction system. Unlike some of the other games in the franchise where you have characters either buy magic spells and abilities to use them, or learn them through leveling up and growing stronger, you instead get them through the summons of this particular installment of the game, known as Guardian Forces, or GFs. Without them equipped to you, all your character can do is attack and not much else. What's more is that one of the major features of the junction system was the ability to attach your magic spells or abilities directly to one of your stats, with different spells giving different bonuses. A cure spell, for example, would give you a lot more health than, say, equipping a fire spell. The problem mostly comes with the fact that not only is this new system a little convoluted, to say the very least, and a drastic departure from how the series previously did all of its spells, but it also actively encouraged you not to cast your spells at all, for fear of reducing your own power in battle. I feel that for the vast majority of players, the problem with this system are twofold, ones that I personally don't have a problem with. The first issue mainly came from how it was explained to the players, as in, it wasn't done all that well. The game kind of front loads a lot of the information to you at the very beginning, and expects you to just jump in and experiment. And with a system that's a great deal more in depth than Materia was, it can be a little overwhelming. And honestly, that would have been fine in and of itself if it wasn't for the fact that, well, the draw system is a thing. You see, one of the first things that players got exposed to when they first booted up Final Fantasy VIII was the draw skill, something that allowed players to go and pull magic from monsters and store it within their character's body. This was, for most players, the only way they understood how you were able to get magic in the game. So when you were getting anywhere from 5 to 9 spells per monster draw in a fight, this often led newcomers to the game sitting in battles for 10 plus minutes, drawing magic every turn so they can max out all the spells that the monsters had all the way up to 100. And when you have over 32 different spells in the game that you can collect, yeah, that could take a while. For a number of the newer players that Final Fantasy VII had brought into the franchise, there was a lot of folks who simply did not care for it. What's the sad thing too is that this is honestly the one element of the game I really can't defend. This system is simply just poorly explained. It makes it all that much more mind-boggling when you consider the fact that when you know what you're doing and are aware of the refined skill that most of the Guardian Forces have, something that allows you to turn items into magic, you can legitimately break this game over your kneecap before even fighting the tank boss at the beginning of the game. The only real defense I can personally give when it comes to the system is that it works with the story that Final Fantasy VIII is trying to tell. And with that segue, let's actually talk about the story. Set in a world that's more technologically advanced than anything else you see in the series, perhaps barring Final Fantasy XIII, the story itself takes place at a military school known as a Garden, where all the students are trained and raised up to become soldiers known as Seeds. Cause it's all about plants, don't you know? Regardless, this is where we meet the main cast that we'll be controlling for the majority of the game. Emo Cadet Squall, who's also named after a weather formation, Brickwall Zell, Hyperactive Bubble Selfie, and Dommy Mommy Quistus. And they're all under the command of Sid of this particular game. Good old Robin Williams here, worshipped is his name. Despite me making jokes, these characters are actually the source of a lot of the player problems within this game, especially since Squall here is the main character. Where a lot of folks found Cloud's problems and trials to either be entertaining or relatable, the vast majority couldn't seem to stand Squall's personality. It didn't help that, well, the major focus of the story in Final Fantasy VIII isn't a fantasy epic or a quest to save the world like the rest of the franchise is known for. It's actually a love story, with Squall being half of that pairing. There are a lot of people who simply could not stand him or the rest of the cast's personalities, much less for the romance that eventually evolves between our main character here and Rinoa, a young woman and eventual sorceress. Though the main problem seems mostly to stem from the characters not developing, or being very flat. And if you're going to be going with the main story alone and looking at Final Fantasy VIII like you would some of the other games in this franchise, then yes, I would 100% agree with you, it doesn't really work. But therein lies the problem I think that people have with it, especially for those who haven't played the game in years. They went through the major storyline and nothing else. More so than I think any other Final Fantasy, 8 has a lot of side content that develops the characters, deepens their relationships, and overall makes them more interesting. Like, take Zell for example. He actually has this entire little plot thread to go get one of the items to get him more of his final limit break that involves you actually talking to his crush, a pigtailed girl who works at the Garden's library. You eventually help her confess her feelings to Zell, and depending on how much you've actually talked to her with our punch master in your party during the game, will actually change how the conversation goes in the end. Then there's also Selfie and her love of the Garden Festival. While it's not as in-depth as Zell's own little side activities, there are choices here that can reflect just how much she's wanting to do the event and her love of making people happy. It's these and other moments like this that are what really makes the cast of 8 interesting in their own ways. They don't have these huge grandstanding parts of the adventure to define themselves, but these little character moments that really flesh them out if you take the time to look at them. Another problem I think when it comes to the character personalities that a lot of people have when it comes to entering Final Fantasy VIII is simply the perception that they have. Every other single game in this franchise has instances where the characters are fighting for their very lives, having to survive or being ordered by a king or dealing with evil organizations, stuff like that. Downtime is a rare commodity that our characters can usually only gain by being completely bedridden or when the story is wanting to leave you with a false sense of security. By comparison, 8 has a lot of moments where the characters are able to sit down, talk, and process what's happening to them. If you take a moment to really look at it, that's when you understand why there's such a big disconnect when it comes to the story for this game compared to its siblings. It is not written like a Final Fantasy. It's written like an anime. And when you get down to it, it's not all that surprising that this is the major feel you'll get from this game, especially since part of the inspiration for the design and character elements did come from anime. Not only that, but the developers of Final Fantasy VIII wanted a game that was nowhere near as dark or dreary as VII had been, especially since this world was going to be coming right on the heels of a game that, let's be entirely honest, did not have a happy ending. Finally, I think we do have to talk about one of the biggest issues when it comes to people in Squall, and that's him and his inner thoughts consisting mostly of whatever. To put it simply, this is a translation issue. While 8 was one of the better adapted games of the Final Fantasy franchise, there are still problems with it. The translators themselves actually did not get the scripts for the game until several months after the fact, forcing them to play through the games themselves to understand the story and having to translate it there. It didn't help that there was also no one-to-one way to convey certain character actions or choices. Those whatevers that we were getting from Squall throughout the entire game? The actual Japanese is more along the lines of a my bad or a sorry. Something more of a I really don't have much to say kind of feel to what he's trying to convey, instead of the sawed-off feeling that the whatever comment eventually gave us. And when your very word choice changes the tone and feel of the main character of the game itself, you're gonna run into a couple of issues. Even with me saying all of this though, there are some legitimate and big issues that even I can't always ignore or explain away. Like how the whole sorceress and time compression thing are kind of just shoved into the end of the game with little explanation. Or how Squall, after believing another character is dead, freaks out about not wanting people to talk about him in the past tense, and outright abandons the group, only for him to go up and walk to them not 10 minutes later and continue on with the story like nothing ever happened. There are moments like this scattered throughout the entire game. I think when you come right down to it, the major problem of Final Fantasy VIII as a whole could come down to a lack of time. There was barely a year difference between this game and its big brother, with all the details that I found saying that 8 started its development while 7 itself was still being worked on and finished. Because of this lack of focus, the short timetable, and the simple fact that there were less developers on it compared to the previous game hurt it. They simply did not have the time or ability to put in as much thought into the stories, the characters, or the gaming systems, which led us to the adventure Squall has had today. It's the potential, though, that I think shines through and part of what hooked me into it. There's a fantastic game with an epic story in here, but it just doesn't quite hit that mark that we're expecting from a Final Fantasy. But that doesn't stop me from appreciating what it tried, loving it for what it did, and enjoying the parts of it that I can have fun with. And worst comes to worse, I'll always have some Triple Triad.